This is Ham Radio Now, episode 262. Digital modes. Wait, I think I need. I think this needs echo. Digital modes now and for the future. Yeah, echo is appropriate. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and we'll get to the program in a moment. It's from the Dayton Hamvention. Yes, this year's Dayton Hamvention, 2016. Still got a few more things to dig out of the old hard drive and put together from that. But we'll get there in just a moment. First, something pretty important. And for this episode, the digital voice thing, I think it will be worth taking a quick stop here. And normally this is the time we would talk about Arvin, who's sitting back there saying he will relinquish his spot for this other contribution thing. It's the Kickstarter for getting me over to St. Petersburg, Florida, to record the ARRL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference that is coming up in September down in St. Petersburg. So I've got a Kickstarter running. It goes until, well, let's take a look at it first. The easiest way to get there is to stop by the Ham Radio Now webpage, do this click here to enter thing, and get the cursor over there. Once we get there, yes, this is very prominent, the Kickstarter links all over the place. Just click on my face. So 26 days to go as I record this. 28 backers have come up with a total of $2,360 of the $5,000 goal. So almost halfway there. And we started with 31 days to go. So that's pretty good. It has tapered off in terms of contributions or in terms of backers, but has not disappeared entirely. So this will help a little bit. Those of you gathered for the digital voice talk, many of you interested in the stuff that will be going on at the DCC, because this talk is Bruce Perens and Chris Testa and moderated by Mel Whitten. So if you're interested in helping me get down to the DCC and get the video on it, and yeah, I suspect that you probably are, Bruce Perens and Chris Testa. Bruce will probably be there. I don't know about Chris. Chris might be there. So go to the hamradionow.tv website, this one here, and click on my picture or any of the other links you find. And for now, don't bother going to the bottom and clicking on Arvin, because this has a deadline. 26 days to go, August 21st, and a goal, $5,000. And with all Kickstarters, if you don't reach the goal, you get nothing. So I feel pretty confident about this. So digital voice now and in the future. Was that what it was? I think so. Let me take a look at the forums listing. Make sure I get this exactly correct. Digital modes now and for the future. So not just digital voice, digital modes. Although I think most of what they're going to be talking about is digital voice. I saw something strange here. This is what was listed in the Hamvention program when they got started. Algoram Stretch, the world's longest microphone cable. I don't think that Bruce actually talked about that very much. In fact, what he talked about and what you'll see in the program is how, and we talked about this at the end of the D-Star program, if you watch that, is how the dream of Catena, the all digital mode plus analog and almost all frequencies, VHF and UHF and up close to the microwaves, that radio is not going to happen quite the way they were hoping for it. So Bruce is going to talk about what is going to happen instead and the timetable for that, although I'm not going to hold him to it. And then Chris Testa is, and he's also going to talk about the digital voice system that David Rowe down in Australia is working on, the SM2000. It'll be a mobile radio that will do analog FM and free DV. Probably not the other digital modes, but free DV. And the claim to fame for that will be that it is very narrow. Fitted in a 6.5 kilohertz channel, the same as D-Star does, but it'll be even a little bit narrower than D-Star is. And although Bruce doesn't talk about it, when I talked to David Rowe about it, one of the cool things that he was talking about was that it is going to be a TDMA, time domain, the ability to switch between transmit and receive very quickly, and essentially form a repeater on one single channel. No input frequency and output frequency, everything's on one channel. Transmit for a few tens of milliseconds, receive for a few tens of milliseconds, and then funnel that over to the transmitter. I don't know if he's still planning on that or not. Bruce is talking about a timetable for that release. I went over to David Rowe's website. I don't see that timetable. I don't see any extra information. But Bruce will talk about it anyway, and we'll be updated as time goes by. Then Chris Testa is also going to talk about the Katana project, and he's going to do something unusual. He's going to talk about how it didn't work and the trouble that he had with it. And not so much maybe about what's coming next. Bruce talks about what's coming next. Chris will get pretty deep into the stages that he got to in designing the Katana radio, or the white box, or whatever you want to call it, and where he ran into trouble. So I'm not sure where things will go next. They also talk about some of the other stuff that is happening in digital voice. Not the future so much of things like D-Star and DMR, the Fusion, and even Kenwood's new radio for D-Star. They'll mention those things in passing. They're more interested a little bit in the radio from the DV4 folks, the one that they have proposed that is going to be all the digital modes and analog FM as a mobile radio to begin with. They'll talk about that a little bit, not in any great depth because they don't have information in depth, which leads me to the last thing I want to mention before we go to the talk, is that you have heard a lot if you've been watching Ham Radio Now and or going to the Tapper conferences or going to the forums at Dayton. You have heard a lot about the radios that Chris and Bruce are not able to produce on the schedule they were hoping to be able to produce them on, and maybe not quite the same radios at all, and you will continue to hear what they are planning. You haven't heard very much at all about the DV4 mobile radio. Those guys have not been to Tapper. They didn't make a presentation at the Hamvention. They had a booth, and a few people have had a couple of interviews with them, but the interviews never brought out much more than the things you see on their website, which is a list of features. So I appreciate the fact that Bruce and Chris are willing to go out on a limb, you know, maybe not a limb quite so much as just present the information, let you follow along what they're doing, and when things didn't work, get pretty specific and detailed about how they didn't work and where they're going to go next. But I'm not going to hold them to any timetables. Okay, you shouldn't either. All right, so that's where we stand on digital modes for, wait a minute, digital modes for the future. Let's go to Dayton.
Good afternoon. My name is Mel Witten. We'll get started here in a little bit. Digital modes now and for the future. And I'm happy to say we have Chris Testa and Bruce Perens with us today. And if we have time, we'll have a little forum later, and we'll talk about some new digital modes as well. So hang on just a second, and we'll get started. Yeah, Bruce will be with us in just a moment. Bruce, as you know, is a computer programmer and advocate of free software movement. He created the open source definition, and he published the first formal announcement and manifesto of open source. He co-founded Open Source Initiative OSI with Eric Raymond. We're very happy to have Bruce here with us today, and he'll be ready in just a moment. Also, we'll have Chris Testa, KD2BMH. He's a designer and a manufacturer of low-power software-defined radio aimed to fit in a handheld, a smartphone-like form factor. His goal is to aid in reducing the cost of and creating new opportunities for communications worldwide. So how's the Hamfest been so far for everybody? Have you been had a chance to come by Bruce's booths in the arena at 76 and 77? We're also demonstrating some free DV there. and you get a chance to see it work through a remote transmitter receiver. So here we go. Here's Bruce Perens. Thank you, Bruce.
It's so nice when the equipment actually works. Yeah, okay, and we are, of course, because we want to walk the walk and talk the talk, we are showing from a Linux system. So when I talk about digital voice this year, what I'm actually talking about is not D-Star System Fusion DMR, DPMR. What I'm talking about is the digital voice that is actually being developed from top to bottom by radio amateurs. And so the fundamental difference, if you're familiar with D-Star and System Fusion, and DMR, is that all of those modes are based on a codec chip that did not come out of amateur radio. It comes from a company called Digital Voice Systems Incorporated. It's depending on the mode, I think APCO uses one before this, but the one that most systems use is called AMBI. And AMBI, for a long time, was closed, so hams couldn't do any of the things that hams like to do with it, which is modify it, make their own, etc. And this got me kind of annoyed. And through a long circuitous path, I actually found and lured into working on amateur radio a guy named David Rowe, VK5DGR, who has a PhD in digital voice coding. I've never met anyone else who has a PhD in digital voice coding. And David, for a PhD project in around 1990, had written his own codec, which the code was in his thesis and sat on the shelf. But if you look at the patents that are filed by DVSI and other companies, they all cite David's thesis. So we knew that this was the real deal. And so David created a codec for us, which we call Codec 2. You know, everything else being Codec 1. And Codec 2 is entirely open source. And Codec 2 has a number of modes. And the lowest bandwidth mode puts voice into 700 bits per second. You can type that fast. And is not really pleasant for rag chewing. And then we go up to 1200 bits per second, 1600 bits per second. And we get to digital voice modes that are pleasant for rag chewing. Now, if you look at the codecs that you have in System Fusion, DMR, etc., D-Star, those codecs are all running at a minimum of 4800 bits per second. And in the case of System Fusion, I think we're getting up to 19.2 kilobits per second. And the interesting thing is we can give you the equivalent quality to D-Star in a codec that uses 2400 bits per second or less. And this is open source software. It's written in C. You can get it. You can learn about it and hack on it. The next step was writing modems. And we have a number of modems that I'll be talking about. So I have a company called Algoram. And Chris Testa here, KD2BMH, is a electronic engineer and programmer. And Chris and I were working on a project that hasn't quite worked out, which is called Katena or White Box. And some of you have been seeing about that project on Ham Radio Now. And what happened was we spent 4 years building radio and the RF performance wasn't quite adequate. And we looked up at that point and said, you know, there are better chips now than there were 4 years ago. So we're actually going to a different design. Now, if you were at the Digital Voice Conference, you may have noticed that I said that if we didn't have a product at this show, I would set Chris on fire. Fortunately, You can't set a fire at Har Arena. It would be Cincinnati Hamvention next year if you did. But there were a couple of mistakes we made. The biggest one probably is we made the computer work before we worked on RF. Next time we'll do that in parallel. So I wanted to talk about what I call the Phoenix radio, because it's out of the ashes from our last project. This is based on a new chip from Lime Micro, and it's, if you've seen the Blade RF has the last version of this. This is one IC with two full SDRs in it, like if you've seen a flex, it's sort of like a flex on a chip. But two of them. And this one IC works from 100 kilohertz to 3.8 gigahertz. And the intent was for it to be in femtocells, cellular telephony systems that are very small and maybe handle a block or the inside of a store or something like that. But it's all open as far as programming the chip. The documentation is open. You have to sign up for a few things, but you don't have to sign a big NDA. So when you have this kind of SDR board that goes from 100 kilohertz to 3.8 gigahertz, it's not a radio, okay? You may have seen HackRF, you may have seen other SDR boards. Okay, what's the difference between those and a radio? They have too much spurious outputs to pass FCC specs for amateur radio until you put filters for the band that you're working on. They also need amplification, okay? In the case of HackRF, they even need front-end amplification. So the main item for us to design in this next generation radio that we're now making is filters and amplifiers, where the rest of the SDR is done for us. And we expect to be able to show product by Hamcation. That's very ambitious. So the Lime Micro LMS7002M is two full transceivers on board with two MIMO ports for each transceiver, 12 bits INQ, and the bandwidth is actually limited by your interface. So if you use USB 3, you get 64 mega samples per second, and that's how much you can put through USB 3. So that's the entire amateur HF spectrum, for example, would fit in that. And then, of course, you can tune it to another band if you want and get that entire band at once. And they have a PCI Express X4 version that gets you higher bandwidth. So you can go up to, I believe, 120 megasamples per second with the PCI Express. So that's the chip. You'll notice chips don't have legs anymore. Okay, they have balls on the bottom. Good luck on soldering that. Okay, and this is the diagram of the chip. So you can see there's a lot of what you would have in an entire radio. And notice the drop shadow. That means that there's two of all of these boxes. So it comes in, there's multiple LNAs. There's a mixer, broadband gain, filters, more gain, and then we go from analog to digital, I and Q, two DSPs, one for each of I and Q, and then we go to the interface. Okay, so it's software from that point on, and if you look at the top, the transmitter is pretty much like that. Comes in from the interface from the computer, DSPs, digital analog converters for I and Q, filtration, gain, mixing, more gain, and output. So a lot of what you would have seen in a radio, this is what it looks like on a PCB board. You can see the USB connector on the left. Okay, so pretty small SDR. You can see the MIMO ports there. There are seven ports in all. here's what the other end looks like. And then here's the PCI version. And these are actually being crowdfunded right now. The nice thing about it is I have a prototype, so I know that they're really going to come out with them. And the crowdfund is for November delivery, and the USB version is for about $300. So if you want to get into designing a really cool radio, it's a good way to do it. And this is the block diagram of the card rather than the chip. So you can see there's USB 3 peripheral. There's EEPROM to load the software. There's a large FPGA for your digital processing. Lots of RAM, RF matching. So another radio that is, if you are not experimenters on the bleeding edge, which I bet you most of you are not, this is what is coming out almost immediately. David Rowe, the maker of the codec, has made a VHF handheld SDR radio with codec 2 and 2400 bit per second 4 FSK modem. And I'll show you the PCB for that in a moment. The nice thing about this and the software behind it is that we can offer you a 10 dB improvement over FM and over legacy digital radios like DMR, System Fusion, and D-Star. And we deliver quality voice starting at negative 132 dBm. And all of your digital voice radios would be dead at that signal and noise level. And that requires an SDR. This does not work on an FM modulator. However, it is 4 FSK, so it works with a Class C amplifier. So what can you do with that? First of all, if you're a mobile, that is 10 extra dB fading margin. So if you drive into a hole, it's not going to sound as bad on this radio as it might sound on D-Star, for example, or FM. The other thing is you can go farther. You can reduce your power. So it may be that you get with 1 watt what you've been getting with 5 watts. Okay, so that's 10 dB of gain over present modes that you can use however you want. It's a 5 kilohertz bandwidth channel, and that is 6.25 kilohertz channel spacing. Brady O'Brien is the modem developer. Could you stand up, Brady? Okay, so Brady is the modem developer. David Rowe, the codec developer, is not here. So there is a, I hope I have these in order, 2400A for conventional radios?
2400B for conventional, 2400A for SDR.
Okay, 2400A for SDRs, and 2400B for conventional FM radios. They're two different modems. So you can use this with your present radio, but it won't get you that 10 dB improvement that we would get with a full SDR. And so David's radio is based on the STM32F7 CPU. There is no operating system. It's bare metal code. Everything is open source. There's nothing that is proprietary. All the software is up on GitHub for you to download, etc. And so why doesn't an analog FM radio work? Well, it low-pass filters the signal, and it otherwise degrades the performance. So we can get a little better performance out of the radio system by using an SDR. We couldn't use an SSB transceiver because 4800 kilohertz is a little too wide. So these days, you know, a good computer costs $5 at the chip level. So why wouldn't you build any radio to be an SDR and get that performance increment? So here's the printed circuit board. And if you look, this is about five different modules, which were all laid out and tested separately, and then just put together on this board. So very conservative in that everything has been tested. We know it works already. So I wanted to talk about the 700B mode. This is for your HF radio. And you may, if you go in the arena, next to the Algorand booth, Mel and Jerry are running the free DV exhibit. And they are doing HF digital voice. They have a Flex in Tampa, and they're just Skyping to it. Flex now comes with our digital mode built in, the 6700, the 6500, and I believe the 6200 as well. So you can just push a digital voice button and go on the air with HF digital voice. It doesn't have this 700-bit mode yet, and that was produced so that we would have a digital mode that actually beat SSB. And we are getting to the point where we can give you a clear and quiet digital voice signal where SSB would not sound as good. David is going to do another pass on this in an attempt to get the voice quality up to a higher level. But we're getting to the point where you may decide to use a digital voice system in contesting sometime in the future. That's going to be interesting. Now, this isn't like digital used to be. Digital used to be sort of all or nothing, where you had a perfect signal or you had no signal at all. Okay, and this is digital that is fading tolerant and falls back. So what happens is if the signal starts to get poor, the voice quality diminishes. It doesn't go away completely. And the way that works is that there is more redundancy on the most important parts of your voice than there is on the less important parts of your voice. So when you get a fade, the pitch may sound wrong, etc., but you can still tell what people are saying, and you get to use your ears for processing, which is what hams are good at. Okay, so this is all new stuff that's being made by radio amateurs. And people used to say, you know, hams aren't innovating anymore. And they're just buying all this commercial equipment and they're using it. And so what's happened here is we've turned around the tables, because if you look at the big three manufacturers of amateur radio equipment, ICOM, Kenwood, Yasu, we are ahead of them in technology at this point. And we want to keep it that way, that companies follow hams rather than hams follow companies. So here's another interesting thing that's on the show floor. This is a DV4 Mini. And this is a little USB dongle SDR, which goes up to about 7 milliwatts. You can get it in UHF or VHF. This is not open source software. This is their own proprietary software. And it is compatible with D-Star DMR, System Fusion, and DPMR. So they've done some development that we have not done yet in the open source world. We have an open source implementation of AMBI that does D-Star, barely. And we need people to work on it, and I've sort of held off on that until I had a radio to sell. And they've come out with a VHF version as well. And this either plugs into your Windows laptop or it plugs into a Raspberry Pi. If you've gone by the MCM booth, they're selling Raspberry Pis like hotcakes. And so this is a $35 complete computer with HDMI graphics and USB and Ethernet. And it runs, out of the box, it runs something called Raspbian, which is a version of Debian Linux. And Actually, it runs 32-bit Raspbian, and we're going to have 64-bit software for Raspberry Pi pretty soon. People are working on the 64-bit kernel right now. One of the issues is just making sure that all of the 32-bit interfaces will still work when we do that. And Raspberry Pi has four cores, and what's it? Somewhere over a gigahertz? 1.6 gigs? 1.2. So pretty powerful computer, the Raspberry Pi 3 for $35. And so you can plug that dongle into it and use it for, we used to have the DB dongle to get into all of these digital networks from your home. This sort of replaces that. And the same company is showing a prototype of a 20-watt mobile. So this is a two-band 20-watt mobile, which will run D-Star DMR. They call it C4FM because they don't want to break the trademark, but it's System Fusion. And they expect to tell you what the price is by the end of the year. That's not necessarily sell it by the end of the year. So this gets by one of these problems, which is you guys, if you're doing digital voice right now, you're sort of buying into a manufacturer's fiefdom. Okay, where we had ICOM for D-Star, and Kenwood is apparently jumping on that bandwagon. And we have Yasu for System Fusion, and never the twain will meet unless you just go over to FM. And so other manufacturers are implementing compatibility with these systems so that you can have everything, which is the way it really should have. I don't believe that you will get to do all of the programming that we can do on our hardware on this, although they've published an API. It's proprietary. So that's sort of what's coming up. We expect at Hamcation, so Hamcation is what, 6 or 8 months? Okay, so we expect to have some more end-user digital radios that come from other companies than the big three on exhibit, including a production radio that runs Codec 2 and our 2400B modem, the one from David Rowe, the SM2000, and believe that that will be an improvement over D-Star and System Fusion and everything else. We will be showing the prototype of the SDR that I'm working on by then. We're not going to have a product to sell, but I hope that we'll have something really credible by then. And so the message here really is we're trying to switch this from the point where digital voice is sort of an appliance operator thing, where not only do most hams not get into the inside, they're not even allowed in the inside, okay? And we're switching that around to the point where, hey, not everyone has to do that. Not everyone wants to be a computer hacker. But enough of us will that we're making cool things for everyone else. And the basic thing that we do to make that happen is we come out with radios that are open platforms for software development and have room for you guys to write apps and to expand. So that's the exciting thing that's happening right now. So Mel, I believe, is going to introduce Chris Testa, and Chris Testa is going to talk about his SDR development.
Okay, thank you, Bruce. Very informative. So we've got a lot to look forward to the next year, that's for sure. So next we have Chris Testa, KB2BMH, and he's going to talk about some projects that he's been working on. And so without further ado, here's Chris. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Mel. Thank you, Bruce. Thank you all for coming. How many people were here last year when at the Digital Voice talk? A couple? Oh, wow. Okay. Just a couple. All right. So last year, you guys are in for an interesting treat, because last year I came here and had this whole design that I had put together and manufactured, and we were in the stages of we were in the early stages of turning the board on. Like, the board had just come off the assembly line. You know, we had our new design. We had been working through it, doing all, turning it on piece by piece. And when we came here, I went over the circuit board, the schematic, the design, you know, the features, what it would do. You know, and really it was like a capturing of all of these different things that we kind of had this dream for of the HT of the future, right? Bruce has been talking about the HT of the future for a long time. I came to it from a different perspective. I was, to just tell you a little bit about why I started working on software radio and how I got into the ham world, I was, I had quit my job, I had got burned out, I'm a software engineer. I'd done the startup ring and was like done with that. So I decided to go backpacking all up and down through the Sierras. And when I was up in Lassen Volcanic National Park, for some reason I bought my smartphone with me, which had just come out like 4 years ago. Smartphones were like a new thing. You know, they started like 5. It's crazy how quickly they've just become so, you know, they're everywhere. But I was, I brought this device with me, and I was wondering, you know, like, why won't this thing work out in the backcountry? Like, what is it about this device? Like, I'm a software guy. What is it that makes it not usable? What are the things? Is it political reasons? Is it technical reasons? You know, what are the limitations? And that got me connected with the amateur radio group, in particular, got me connected with Tapper, the Tucson Amateur Packet Radio Group. I was watching Northwest Digital Radio and saw all of the people who were working on SDRs coming to the Tapper DCC to talk about the latest and greatest advancements and what they were working on. And I just had to get involved. And I learned that if I was a licensed amateur radio operator, I could communicate with the world from anywhere. I could bring a radio to the top of a mountain and get a communication out, whatever it was. So I knew that this was something important to me, something that I wanted to spend, you know, my energy on, to figure out how you would go about doing it. And so there's been 4 years now that I've been working on this. So, you know, just a little background, I studied computer engineering at the University of Maryland. After graduating, I moved to Los Angeles. I first worked at Google on the search engine and then moved over to working on YouTube. So I got to really be in like the cloud computing world. I was like up in there. Whereas when I went to school, I was very interested in FPGAs and circuit design and all that stuff. So, you know, but the money and the jobs were mostly in building software. So that's what I got into. I'm an Eagle Scout, and you know, I'm always like, be prepared is, you know, one of a motto that I live with, something that I always think about, and what I was thinking about when I was in Lassen. And I was like, well, what if I broke my foot while I was out here? How would I let people know? So I believe in a free and open internet. In particular, you know, so I'm the internet generation. Like, I do remember the time from before the internet existed, but especially young people, I see a few in the audience, they don't even know what was going on back then. And I can't imagine the world now today without free and open access to the internet and communication. It just doesn't make sense. So I want to work on stuff that will get people connected and make sure that we can all be connected no matter what. So I started building this white box project in 2013. I actually thought of the idea in 2011 in December, and then that following year I started to really understand like what kind of things would I need to use. I bought a bunch of different dev kits from different companies. There was a paper that my friend who was in grad school at the University of Michigan, his coworkers, the people on his team, had just written a paper called Putting a Software Radio on a Low-Calorie Diet. And it was all of this, all these advancements that were happening and these things called FPGAs and or field programmable gate arrays and these highly integrated SDR transceiver chips that were all like coming out on the market, and they had built this very small radio that was a standalone SDR, which at the time there was all every SDR you had to plug into a computer in order to do something with it. So you needed multiple devices. They were just peripherals. Whereas this was a full standalone device. So I tried to take ideas from their design and what I could find in the market that would apply to amateur radio bands and kind of hobbled together a bunch of dev kits, went to a university, had access to a spectrum analyzer for a week, a really nice LaCroix. It cost more than my car. And we got a lot of stuff done that first week. I got the transmitter to work. I got the receiver to work. I mean, there were no amplifiers. There were spurious emissions everywhere. The sensitivity wasn't, you know, something that, you know, we would expect for ham equipment. But, you know, it was promising. So I quickly typed up a paper, went to the Tapper conference, met a bunch of the people who are sitting in the room right now who have been along with me on this journey to get here. So at this point, I actually have a day job again. I'm back building software. I spent a lot of time and energy working on the white box project. Still have to feed myself. Still haven't made a completely working finished radio. And what we're going to get into now is kind of an assessment or maybe a postmortem of the white box Charlie or third iteration of the board and see what went right, what went wrong, and what we're going to do in order to ultimately reach the original vision, which to me is, you know, ubiquitous communication everywhere, not with these radios that I have to, you know, turn a bunch of dials with a little screen that I can't read, but with modern communication stuff like, you know, a smartphone or something that everyone's using everywhere. So that's a picture of the third design. This was actually by far the most complicated circuit board I ever built. There's 620 parts on the board. It had a 23-page schematic. It was very complicated. We decided to do a six-layer board for it, which had both pros and cons. I was able to make a cleaner RF design section, but then there were also flip sides where there was more noise everywhere, and I wasn't as clean about where the current was going to flow on different parts, and there's weird and interesting couplings going all over the place. So what happened in particular? There's a little XKCD. I thought that would be appropriate for this. So we'll just kind of go through the different parts of the design. So one of the things that I decided to do for the third version was I really segregated the RF section from the baseband section. I treated them as two separate things. And that worked really well. The interface was really nice, and I could bring each part of the board up separately. But what I think was something that didn't work well for that was I put both boards that could have been separate boards on one board. And then you have this like interesting coupling where, you know, you have a rail, a voltage rail over here, and then you turn that voltage rail on, and then it's going to turn on other parts, and then there's just like these weird complicated, it had a very complicated turn on in order to turn on every subsection of the board to be able to, you know, test everything and know that it worked together. In particular, there was one net, this 5-volt analog rail that did go across from both buses that when I first got the board back from the manufacturer, putting a resistor on that rail to connect it in just connected a short. And it wasn't an electrical short, you know, like a continuity tester wouldn't find any problem, but there was some other issue. And, you know, we ended up debugging it, but it was a pain in the butt. So the power section of the board, this one we spent a lot of time on. We were very interested in making something that you could connect mobily to your car. So we wanted to make sure that it worked with 12-volt rails and, you know, could deal with kind of the noisy environment of your car alternator. So we put lots of stuff that I didn't have on previous boards. In particular, I put good reverse polarity protection and transient voltage suppression, which actually definitely saved one of the prototypes at least one time that I'm aware of, but I probably got saved other times from it. But on the failure side, so I had two switching regulators, and one of them was for the 3.3 volts that would run the computer. And that one, like I laid out really tight and really well, and it worked fine. But the one that I made for the 5-volt net that would be to power like an external USB device that you could plug in, that one net in particular in the feedback loop had a long trace. And the amount of current there, or the amount of potential difference on that trace was incredible. If I touched something close to that trace, then it would blow that whole subcircuit. So I actually blew two of them before I decided to just not work on that for the rest of the Charlie design. Just let that.
And that's a six-layer board.
Yeah, and that's a six-layer board. So next section. So this board had auxiliary analog to digital converters and digital analog converters. There's lots of things that you want to measure on a board. There's temperatures, there's service level or RSSI, there's offsets, biases, so many things to measure. So I added additional chips to measure these things, and that all worked correctly, but there's a Linux computer on the board, and the chips that I used have drivers with the most recent version of the Linux kernel, but given the module that I used, I didn't have access to those drivers. So there was a lot of things where it was like, wow, it would have saved a lot of time if I was just using a more recent version of the kernel, and I wouldn't have had to rewrite all this stuff.
And that meant a different CPU.
Yeah, and so that kind of implies a different CPU. So for clocking, so I decided to go different for this one. I used a single 10 megahertz reference clock with a clock distribution buffer. I liked that model. I think it worked well, but what didn't work well, which something that like should have connected in my head, was that I had a clock that was a step function, like a digital clock. And so that means that all of the odd harmonics of that clock were very powerful. And those clocks had to go to the oscillators on the RF section, right? So, and then the little icing on the cake was that the intermediate frequency was 90 megahertz, which is the ninth harmonic, which was powerful enough that when I had all of that on, it really hurt the sensitivity of the receiver. Because now in the passband, there's like this big spike from the clock. So lesson learned. For the main analog to digital converter, so this was the third board. I used the same ADC and DAC, and these parts worked really well. But I tried to be smart this time, to be power efficient, I had a separate analog and digital rail, and I would only turn on the analog rail if I wanted to actually use the transceiver, whereas a digital rail would always be on because the computer would be on. But there was an unknown, or something that's not in the data sheet that I poured over looking for afterwards, where for the ADC that I chose, if you power up the digital rail and not the analog rail, it will just consume as much current as you give it. So it looked like the chip was shorted out, when in actuality, it was just that both rails had to come up at the same time. And so we were banging our heads against this one for a long time. I mean, we put this chip down. Luckily, it was a leaded chip, so you could put down some traces and leave some up and leave some down, and we're measuring impedances around the board and then voltages around the board, and there's nothing wrong. We can't find anything wrong. We have no idea what's wrong. And then finally, we just connect the 5-volt rail as well, and just works. So there's a lot of really interesting challenges that you face when you decide to make a big, complicated design. And even circuits that were like very safe for me, that were like very clean, that I had done on multiple revisions prior. The smallest little change basically means you have to treat it like a brand new subcircuit. And so that was another very interesting lesson. So the main module that we used on the white box, Charlie, was something called the Smart Fusion 2. And this is a really cool advanced field programmable gate array / system on a chip computer system that like you could find in a Sidewinder missile. It's like state of the art. It's so cool. It's not a big enough and popular enough system to have like all of the engineering effort to port the most recent Linux kernel to it, like let's say the Raspberry Pi has. So there was a lot of there's no MMU on the device as well, but it's just that was something that frustrated me. Even though I had a lot of the Linux kernel available and a lot of the drivers available, it was still like a version of the Linux kernel that you would find in a router from like, you know, 2 or 3 years ago, and not a version of the kernel that you would find in any kind of modern system. As far as human-computer interaction, so we had push-to-talk buttons, reset buttons, push-to-talk, open-drain outputs, open collectors. We had all different things that you could, bells and whistles that you could use to integrate with it. And all that stuff actually all worked out of the box just fine. But it was all stuff that probably could have just been on its own separate daughter card with like a little, you know, little interface, you know, little like 100 mil header that you could plug in and just simplify the design of the main board.
One more success there. You could walk across the carpet and touch the key and it would blow your radio.
Yeah, so we did put a lot of ESD protection on all the buttons and switches, which was cool and worked, so that's nice. So in the peripherals, the Smart Fusion 2 had a USB on the go, and we put the USB on the go transceiver on there, and that was actually really interesting because it opened up a lot of different possibilities. I was able to get a Wi-Fi access point running on it, so it would really be like a Wi-Fi router that then had additionally a VHF, UHF radio on it, which is something that really interests me, that I could connect my phone Wi-Fi to it and then have that, you know, use the radio to communicate out with the world. I was also able to hook up sound cards so you could, you know, just talk right into it at a microphone and speaker. All that was cool. But the Smart Fusion 2, you know, the design that I chose or the company that makes the chip, they put, for whatever reason, they put the Ethernet transceiver on the module instead of on the baseboard. And so then this important differential signal has to go through all these like weird connector onto the baseboard, so they couldn't put a gigabit Ethernet on it, even though the microcontroller itself could support it. And you know, it's pretty easy to hit 100 megabit, like especially when you're shuttling samples around. You know, if you have multiple mega samples per second that you want to get across the wire, like you need a higher bandwidth bus, or else you have to add more, you know, signal processing onto the embedded device. So it became like this chicken and egg trade-off of like, what am I gonna build? And that had something to do with it. And I will admit, I don't know if there's an FTDI USB UART like anonymous group, but like, I'm Chris, and I'm addicted to the FTDI USB UART, even though it's a bad chip. So now we could start talking about the RF section, and this is where you know, gets more interesting about the stuff that I discovered. On this board, we put a lot more power rails or low dropout regulators, so we could have, you know, like the PLLs and the oscillators have, you know, lower noise sensitivity to other portions of the board, have them more isolated. That worked really well. We probably went overboard on it, but you know, for a development setup, you know, you can always like short those later on and see if there's an impact, and then decide on the next revision if you want to do it. So I would probably still do that on the next design. So we had this thing that we called the gateway, And basically what I ended up using it for was I needed like antenna switches and bandpass filter switches. So I needed to code some logic where I could like turn on different GPIOs. And instead of having all those GPIOs pinned out from the main microcontroller, I made this little side spy system, a little spy slave. So I wrote a little bit of Verilog, and then that I could just write to from the Linux kernel, and that would flip on and off the different rails. I really liked that because one part was needed instead of like, you know, probably 10 or 12 discrete AND or gates. But the problem with that CPLD, it's the Xilinx, like it's the main one. It's actually also used in the HackRF, the higher end version of it. I use the smallest one that they sell. But it's like, it's a big, big chip. So it took up a lot of space. And the other option for it, the package, is a BGA. And it's like smaller than your pinky nail. And I'm not gonna hand solder one of those. So, you know, that's like another one of those annoying things. So synthesizers. Okay, so this is a superhet design. So there's two local oscillators on the board, one for the IF and one for the RF. On the Bravo board, the second revision of the design, we found that the IF oscillator that's like built into the main transceiver chip has some really nasty like phase noise issues. And that's fine a lot of the time for digital stuff because you can move your signal away from the carrier and then suppress it later on. But for amateur use, sometimes you wanna, you know, if you wanna just do like the simplest CW, like you just wanna turn on and off that oscillator. So we decided to replace that oscillator with a different one, and that one worked really well. That was actually, I think I talked about that last year, how I discovered that oscillator was very, very noisy. But the failure, and this failure kind of goes to the, you know, it goes from 50 megahertz to 1,000 megahertz. It slices and it dices. Like, it's very hard to meet all of the specifications for all the spurious emissions, for all of the bands, without having lots and lots of additional filters and switches and across the board. This includes in the local oscillator. So I did put filtering on all the oscillators, but it wasn't enough and in the right places depending on the band in order to meet spurious or requirements. So, you know, would have required another board turn with additional thinking about what we'd want to do there. The main transceiver chip that we used was something called the CMX991, and there's still a manufacturer, Northwest Digital Radio, is still looking to come out with a software radio based on that chip.
Even later than us.
So what I liked about what I did for that chip was I put these little UFL connectors everywhere. Like maybe you've seen them from your Wi-Fi. If you have like a Wi-Fi card, it'll have like this very tiny coaxial connector for you to connect an antenna. And these are like very small and very easy to kind of like litter around on the board without needing to reroute traces in all different ways. So I put these all over the place, and they actually were really useful to be able to see, you know, as the RF system, as a signal flowed through the RF system, you know, how much attenuation was happening at each stage or gain, you know, what other sorts of couplings were happening across the board as things were going through. So that was a really good debug aid. But the failure was, or you know, the problem was that I switched from 45 megahertz to 90 megahertz, and this meant that I had to replace this really interesting SAW filter, or they had a crystal filter, and then I needed to use a SAW filter, and the matching network for it was definitely a challenge for me to figure out the right way to get the matching done. So you know, it's not like a 50 ohm system into a 50 ohm system. It's like I have an S parameter, two S parameter charts or Smith charts, and then you kind of have to go through and figure out, you know, what components to use. And I was never able to get, you know, so I had to kind of do it guess and check style. You know, I know some of the math that you would want to go through to look it up or how to use the Smith chart, but at my attempts never resulted in like as good of a performance as the RF guys did at the company that made the reference design. So, you know, that's something that I want to get better at, and that's something that I'm interested in learning about more and practicing more of. That was a unique kind of subcircuit to build for this particular transceiver chip. So on the transmit path, the goal was to output 100 milliamps from 50 megahertz to 1,000 megahertz. And so that actually did work on one of the bands. But on the other bands, I would need a lot more complicated broadband matching than what I put on the board in order to have it be, you know, have it work across that whole frequency range with, you know, to the appropriate level. Like certain, there was like a curve where certain frequency or certain bands it would amplify really well, other bands it wouldn't. Other bands there would be weird oscillations, you know, so there's a lot of there's a lot of devils in the details when it comes to building a really broadband radio. And also, you know, another big lesson learned is that any like ground current noise or other noise on the board will get picked up by an amplifier and amplified. So, you know, you think you're putting on amplifiers to amplify the signal that you want, but you're also amplifying the signals that you don't want. On the receive path, there was a receive antenna switch, I got the logic backwards for the receive antenna switch, and luckily I was able to fix it in software and didn't have to cut any traces or anything, so that was good. So one of the requirements that we had on the failure side was we wanted to have an onboard noise source so that way you could test the receiver and make sure that the receiver, you know, like, could switch in the noise source and see that the noise floor raises, and then you know that like your whole chain is operating without needing, you know, a full duplex radio. I couldn't find a design for a VHF UHF noise generator that I liked that didn't require a bunch of additional amplifiers and expensive parts. So I kind of didn't like that circuit that much. And you know, while it did operate, like it was basically another PA that was necessary in order just to look at some noise. And the other thing that I did, so I copied a lot of, you know, I how do I figure out what to design for this? Well, I look at like every radio that I can find. I look at all the schematics. I look at all of the layouts and, you know, if they have as much as I can find. So, you know, and a lot of the inspiration, especially for ham stuff, comes from HF gear. So for HF gear, there's completely different set of requirements than what you have for VHF and UHF. And in particular, what I did here was I copied something from the KX2 or KX3, sorry, is that they had for all the bandpass filters, they have one switch for each bandpass that you could switch in, and it can either switch in that filter or it will switch into ground on both sides. Right, so it'll either disconnect that circuit or connect one of them in. The problem is that at like 900 megahertz, the trace that would go down to that point, go down to the end, ended up looking quite like an inductor. And so I would get attenuation even just from that section. So there's other chips that you would want to choose instead if you wanted to have a multi-band radio. It's just harder to buy the parts. Like there are, you know, five pole single throw or single pole five throw switches, RF switches that exist, but you know, there's not like 10,000 of them available on DigiKey. So in summary, the White Box Charlie board was not a quiet RF design. Like I hear the RF folks say that, like, yeah, it takes a couple iterations to get your design to be quiet. And now I have like a more deep understanding of what that actually means and how you go about trying to understand, you know, based on what was there, you know, turning on different parts of the circuit, how that would affect different noises that I was seeing, and trying to understand what the couplings were between the different subcircuits. And, you know, the only real way to gain understanding there is, I think, by experience. So I'm happy that I had the experience, but it was also frustrating. So yeah, and then furthermore, you know, I when I look back at what I wanted to do initially, like I think I initially spec'd a dual band radio, a 2 meter 70 centimeter radio. That's what I originally wanted to design. And, you know, kind of just kept ballooning out. And I think it was, you know, part of it is ego driven. Part of it is, you know, if other are doing it, I can do it too. You know, like if the HackRF can go from, you know, 1 megahertz to 6 gigahertz, well, like, why can't we do that as well? But the requirements are totally different. I mean, you have to put a lot of additional work into a HackRF to turn it into a transceiver that's designed with best engineering practices for, you know, real amateur radio long range RF links. So, oh, another interesting thing. So I used a contract manufacturer that I met on Reddit, and I at first I was really interested in this company. It was really cool, but it turned out that working with a contract manufacturer that you haven't worked with before to build your most complicated design ever is absolutely a recipe for failure. Because then at the end, not only was I concerned about what I had done, but then what had the contract manufacturer done as well? Like some of the parts were turned in different orientations than what I thought I had specified to them. So, you know, basically I had to re-go through on everything and make sure that it was good, and on a 600 part board, that's a really tall order. And, you know, all 0402 parts, or, you know, all QFN packages. So, and then finally, I mentioned this a couple times, not having a full Linux stack, you know, having a halfway Linux stack it's like a tease. You just want all of Linux. So you want like latest Linux. It's just got everything. Most of the chips that I use in this design at this point have check-ins for drivers in the mainline kernel. Even the RF oscillators are in there. And I wrote all custom code to do that. So, you know, I'd rather hop on into the stream of the, you know, what's going on in mainline kernel development and just utilize what everyone's working on. Okay, so that was that, you know, maybe that took a little bit longer. There was a lot to talk about there, but I got a little bit more time. So I would just want to talk about what's going on in software radio land as far as I see it and where I think things are going. I'm on the computer side, I've always been kind of good when I was a kid at seeing where the trends in computers are going. And so in the computer land, one of the things that I really like to use on this project is something called the field programmable gate array system on a chip. And there's a couple of manufacturers that make these things. And it's either Altera, Xilinx, or Microsemi. I chose the Microsemi part. And what we're looking at here is a trend chart of year by year, the kind of like my favorite system on a chip from that year. So this is a little biased, but kind of like the best favorite one of that year. How much power did that chip have? And if you look at the line first, notice 2016. There's no dot here, right? There have been no major releases of FPGAs so far this year in the system on a chip group, but there's a trend line there, and there's like these times where for a few years it kind of flatlines. Like these companies come out with the chip, and then they push it, and then, you know, they're doing development on the next one, but it takes them a lot longer to make an FPGA than it does to make a microcontroller. At least that's my guess based on what this trend line looks like. In contrast, if you look at single board computers, there's like the line, it's kind of hard to see, but to me it looks like there's an exponential growth that's about to break out in these single board computers. And like the real one that really nails it in the coffin for me is that the Raspberry Pi 2 or Raspberry Pi to Raspberry Pi 3 transition, you know, like, is just incredible. So when I started the White Box Project, the Raspberry Pi didn't exist, right? It was Arduino world 4 years ago, right? But if you look, and then when the first Raspberry Pi came out, yeah, pretty cool, but you can't turn that into a software-defined radio. It's not powerful enough. But then the Raspberry Pi 2 came out with quad core. That came out last year just before Hamvention, and I hadn't really caught on to it yet, or hadn't really connected in my head that these single board computers are reaching this like incredible level where they're going to be capable of doing some real software defined radio heavy lifting. And then when the Raspberry Pi 3 came out this year, this one has quad core neon floating point unit with a double wide instruction set. So like you're talking, you can just do a ton of floating point operations. And while this is not the most power efficient, the FPGAs are not the most power efficient either. And you can always underclock a computer and make it slower, and that's what's consuming all the power. So they keep driving up the clock rate, but the clock rate, you know, is always stables out. So I'm very interested in the patterns that are happening with these single board computers. I think that we can expect these things to follow some crazy new kind of law where they, like, how much you can fit in a $35 computer year over year for the next like decade is going to be completely mind-blowing. So how many people have heard of Moore's Law before? How many people have heard of Coomey's Law before? A couple people?
Yesterday.
I did some of these slides yesterday. So Coomey's Law states that the number of computations per joule of energy dissipated has been doubling approximately every 1.5 years since the 1950s. So the first thing to note is 1950s means this trend started happening before transistors, right? So this was back in the tube days as well. And you know, Moore's Law only goes from transistor time. But this is a really interesting result, especially for software-defined radio, because software-defined radio, let's face it, is more power-hungry than the equivalent hardware radio is going to be. I mean, even if I come out with like really focus on it, it's going to be really hard to beat a KX2 or a KX3 in terms of current consumption. But the fact that this trend will continue to go, and I mean, there's like a theoretical limit of where, you know, we'll hit a limit, but I think we have like 100 years with this line that should go, unless we invent reversible computing and then the whole thing goes out with the bathwater. But it's for the foreseeable future, I think things look really bright for SDRs being able to take over more and more of what was traditionally hardware jobs given power budgets, and you know, especially after the Raspberry Pi 2. I think that a lot of the amateur modes, you know, because we're working in, you know, sub 100 kilohertz range most of the time, or 100 kilosample per second range, it's completely doable in these chips. You don't need an FPGA. Whereas 4 years ago, I was 100% convinced that you had to use an FPGA. So that's a pretty big paradigm shift. Along this line, this is another project, I'll just mention it quickly, that I've been working on called the BATOR. And it's with my friend Aaron Schulman out of Stanford University. And this device, what it does is it lets you measure power consumption. And it uses a really, really fun trick where it connects to a phone. And it's like basically a portable power monitor that you can record, you know, the power as it's being consumed in whatever device you want. But what the trick that we use is it flashes the camera a bunch of times in a known pattern. And then you can use cross-correlation to match up the power trace that you measure with this. So you end up being able to have the signal or the power signal line up exactly with a trace of your software program. This is really useful for developers because now you can see how your software program is consuming battery. So before you could optimize for, you know, power, you could either optimize for RAM or you could optimize for time, right? So space-time trade-off. Now you can also optimize, or it's very easy to optimize for power, which is pretty important when you're working on mobile devices. So on the right there, you can see this thing that we call the smartphone interceptor, and that actually, like, if you take your phone, if you take your phone apart and you look at the battery inside, I'll do my little, I always take my phone apart. So here's the battery down here, and then there's a little plug where the battery connects into the phone right there, and you can just kind of connect in series in that line and then just, you know, do a normal power monitor. It's a very simple circuit. You know, it's like 50 parts. It uses an AVR microcontroller. But it's been really fun working on that. So what's next? You know, Bruce talked a bunch about what, you know, what we'll probably be working on for, you know, the next year or so. I'm definitely still very interested in the Northwest Digital Radio because they're using the CMX991, and it would help validate a lot of the, you know, early design decisions that I made in the white box design. I'm very interested in the SmartMic 2000. It's kind of like the opposite idea of what I've been going after because it uses all discrete components. There's no like highly integrated, you know, amplifier chips or anything. Like he's doing it all like raw, old school, and it's really compelling. It's really cool design and has some will be really cool with the new modem that's being worked on. And also, you know, the Lime Micro chip. So Lime Micro, the chip was actually in the first Kickstarted radio, the Blade RF, which came out a number of years ago. Yeah, but the previous generation. And so now, you know, we're experiencing this thing where, okay, so 3 years ago or 4 years ago, you could get a Lime microchip that had one transceiver that would operate, you know, from, you know, a couple megahertz up to 3.8 gigahertz. Now, 4 years later, for the probably cheaper price than what you paid last time, you're getting two transceivers, and it has a wider operating range, and I wouldn't be surprised if it consumes less power and all those other nice things. So we'll probably see this continue to happen over the next bunch of years, where we're just going to fit more and more transceivers into these, you know, system or, you know, transceivers on a chip. And it's, you know, that's going to be really interesting to watch as it happens and be involved with.
And each of those can do multiple narrow band receivers.
Right. So I just also want to mention another project that I've gotten involved with, included with Tapper, is a mesh networking device that an SK by the name of John Stevenson, K6OZH, worked on for numerous years, over a decade, actually. He really wanted to cover the entire San Joaquin Valley with a high-speed wireless internet infrastructure. And when he passed away, he donated all of his equipment, all of his designs, all of his software to Tapper, and including a financial donation. So there's interest in continuing his work. And if you're interested in that, he also built this really cool RISC or reduced instruction set computer, digital signal processor, and an OFDM modem, and was working on mesh networking, like just incredible stuff. Like, you know, seeing him work on this, seeing that this guy worked on all this stuff, which is a lot of stuff that I'm passionate about for so long, it's like, you know, I kind of want to fold in what he was working on into the future of what I'm working on. So all of his code is available. I've posted it with Tapper's permission up on my GitHub. That's the link. David McQuate, WA8YWQ, has his assembler working that he made for that chip. And he's now working on getting the unit test to pass. There's a mailing list. I apparently suck at GNU Radio, GNU Mailer, and I'm the mailing list, like, chair of this and didn't know it for a while, but now I'm receiving the emails correctly. So if you sign up, please, you know, say a message or something. We're trying to drum up interest there. So yeah, so white box, Delta, maybe, fork in the road. What I've been working on lately is, you know, just kind of going back to basics, fun, simple things. It's pretty incredible that for, you know, $70 you can get a Raspberry Pi 3 and an RTL dongle and, you know, in about 15 minutes be receiving APRS or, you know, whatever you want. It's a completely different ball game than what I was, you know, working with when I started 4 years ago. And I wanted to stick with a single design and understand things and move forward and, you know, not be flaky or, you know, run around too much. But, you know, at this point, it's time to look at other options and other things to do. So, yeah, and I mentioned even more integrated transceivers. So I've heard numerous times that like software radio, it's about the software, stupid, right? But it's about the software after you have a solid piece of working hardware. And what I really want to focus on is, you know, the software in many ways are solve problems. There's a lot of software developers who are very eager to, you know, build APRS modems, build interfaces, all those things. There's a lot more programmers than there are people who specialize in RF. So I will continue to, you know, learn about those things, understand the physics better, use the equipment that Bruce has been so generous to let me use, and, you know, just gain further insight into what's really going on, and, you know, ultimately be able to build the radio and deliver on my original intention. Questions? Yeah. Okay. Do you want to? Yeah. Back of the room. So the question is, how much power does the microcontroller take? The Smart Fusion 2, during normal operation, like an idle operation, not in like a sleep state, will consume 110 milliamps at 3.3 volts. In a sleep state, it'll drop down into like the, you know, the tens of milliamps range. And when you're kind of doing like the full transceiver operating, kind of doing like a transmit or receive, it'll consume like 400 milliamps. Oh, the power monitor. Right. Oh, that thing consumes like 20 to 30 milliamps when it's recording samples. Yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
The question more for Bruce. Stand up. Do you know if David's codecs or the flavors, have they been rolling them in into the new radio? I'm thinking of buying a commercial Fermi, which is brought by Angelina, you know, the RR10. That's very fun.
Yeah, so GNU Radio, I believe, has an older version of Codec 2, and there is currently no developer who keeps it up in phase.
GNU Radio builds with the current separate Codec 2 library to stay current.
Yeah.
The release Codec 2, not save experimental.
Yeah. 2. So, and the other one was, what was it, Asterisk, had a really old version of Codec 2 also. So sometimes you're not getting everything you should. I wanted to add one more thing now that I've got my throat back. Chris and I have been doing some really high-risk projects, and as a result, we decided not to crowdfund until we actually had something that we could sell. And as a result, because White Box Katena is what we called it as a product, did not work out, we did not waste anyone's money except some personal money of mine and Chris's. And in reality, most of what we spent for was test equipment. And, you know, of course, we still have the test equipment. We're going to work on more designs after this. I did buy a run of ICs that I thought were kind of difficult to get that we might end up selling off at some point. That's one of the problems that you're going to get into. I have a company called Legal Engineering that works on open source and intellectual property for law firms and their customers and tech companies, and that's essentially subsidized this entire operation of Algorand for something close to 4 years now. And, you know, not everyone can do that, and that's why sometimes people crowdfund. And then it never comes out. And I've definitely spent for more than one radio that has never come out in crowdfunding. We also didn't take investment, and we will probably take investment at some point because this isn't just an amateur project. It has land mobile potential, and land mobile can make you some real money. We're hoping that it actually gets to that point. So if people have questions about the codecs, et cetera, I'll take some more questions about that. Okay, so who uses digital modes today? Okay, so raise your hand for D-Star, for System Fusion, for DMR. And in the case of DMR, who is using a commercial radio ported over to the amateur bands? Yeah, so that's pretty much mostly what DMR is. So that's interesting. You know, some of these radios are reprogrammable. And in the case of a few of them, they can actually be made to use the Codec 2 modem that is for FM radios. They're not going to be able to get this 10 dB improvement, but there are people looking at, can we code the Tytera to have a codec in the chip, etc. Right now, if you're interested in doing this, the main requirement is that all our code is in floating point. Okay, so if you have a fixed point chip, it's not going to work right there. But of course, these days, a lot of the chips are using, a lot of the HTs are using STM32, which does have in its later versions floating point, potentially has enough room to run the codec, because that's what we're actually using in David Rose radio as well. Any more questions? Yeah.
On the Codec 2, is there a main site that's the most up to date?
There are a couple different sites. Freedv.org is the place where you go to get software which you will run on your HF radio. Okay, so it takes your voice. You need two sound cards. You know, one of them can be a headset, a USB headset, and it will put your SSB radio onto digital voice, and quite a lot of experimental software comes out that will run on that. So as the software develops, that's going to get more capable. The Codec 2 site is specifically for the codec rather than the integrated HF software. And then David Rowe has a weblog, and that is Rowetel. R-O-W-E-T-E-L, I think it might be a .com, is that right? And Brady, do you have a blog?
I don't.
Oh, okay, so we're going to mostly read about Brady's work on Rowetel. Okay, there was another question over here somewhere. Any more questions? All right, I think we should let these people go home. Mel, you wanna get up?
Chris, thank you. Thank you, Bruce. I think it's been very interesting, and we look forward to seeing you next year. Do stop by the booth and look at some free DV, and we'll be glad to talk to you there. Thanks again for attending.
I still want a radio. I still want a radio that's going to do all the modes. People have said ham radio should have just one digital mode. Everybody should agree on one single digital mode. And you might be surprised that I disagree. I don't think we should have just one digital mode. I think we should have them all. And there'll be more in the future, because technology is not going to stop. Technology is going to keep progressing. Things will get better. D-Star, for example, is kind of stuck with the vocoder, the Ambi vocoder system that they started with. In order to keep all of D-Star radios compatible, they can't advance from that. Things have advanced in D-Star in terms of peripheral equipment, and now Kenwood is going to have a D-Star radio. And they are putting in probably updated vocoders, but it still has to meet the original D-Star spec. So that means the same bandwidth. It's not going to get narrower. Maybe R2-D2 is not going to go away. That's been, for me, the bane of D-Star. I love everything else about D-Star. I love what it sounds like, and what it sounds like is adequate. I would like to have a little higher fidelity, but that's kind of not going to happen. Although, if you listen on computers using DV dongles and things, and people able to talk into the D-Star system with higher fidelity microphones on their end, D-Star can sound pretty good. A good part of the reason why D-Star sounds kind of crappy is that all the ICOM radios have limited the fidelity that they are putting into the system. But My 2820.
My 2820 sounds terrible. My ID92 sounds a little bit better.
My old ID91 or IC91 handheld sounded pretty good. One of the best sounding D-Star radios out there, but they left that behind and went to stuff that sounds worse. Don't know why. So it could sound better. I like the routing capabilities, the things that it puts in my control by programming stuff into the radio. I like that. I'm not sure how much Fusion has, because I've never had a Fusion radio that worked through their wire system. I had the original set of Fusion radios when I did the review for QST, but the Wires X was not available at that time, so I could never find out just how well they worked and what kind of control they gave me. That stuff is out there now, but I don't have the radios anymore. And I'm not going to get single mode radios. I'm going to wait until the radios are out there that will do everything. So once again, I don't think we should have just one single mode. And I think we should have radios that will do multi-modes. And if you've ever heard me do my long spiel about the way I think things should be, those radios should be upgradable by software and firmware so that when a new digital mode comes out, they're able to take advantage of it. That's what I would like to see. And I'm pretty sure Bruce and Chris want to be able to do that too. The DV4 guys, I don't know. Probably, but they're not talking. I guess I should invite them on here on Ham Radio Now. I should do that soon. If you guys are watching, give me a call. KN4AQ at what? At ARVN.TV? Yeah, that's it. Okay, that's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. And Bruce and Chris and Mel from the Dayton Invention, thank you guys. Once again, Arvin would like you to go to the Kickstarter. Here it is. And again, the best way to get there is from the Ham Radio Now website, because the Kickstarter address is this long, complex series of names and numbers, and you don't want to be doing that. So stop by hamradionow.tv first, and then click on the link, and then you get to the Kickstarter. Is anybody, let me refresh that page. Has anybody else jumped in the time we've been talking? No, not yet, but we are waiting for you. I'm Gary Pierce, 73. Thanks for watching. Over and out.